So just to summarize, what is the semi-custom design flow for what we have? Seen now. There are a few steps, most of them we have already mentioned. First of all, we have the so-called design capture, which means we design the functionality of the chip. It can be a schematic, so a CG design, or it can be a VHDL design, the high level of abstraction. But the complete functionality of the chip is included. In case we can use some external IP block, for example, a complete embedded microprocessor in it if we need it, then the second step from that is a so-called logic synthesis, and at the end of the logic synthesis, which is a quasi-automatic process, we end up with a netlist, a gate netlist. Plus some placement and routing constraint. What are these constraints? Because of course at the level of the gate netlist we need also to have limitations, for example, in the maximum delay of the due to the interconnections, and this limitation on the delay due to the interconnections translate in a limitation on the in a constraint in the placement of routing. For example, do not put these two blocks too far away, okay, with some, let's say, quantitative limitations. This part is important, especially for, let's say, complex chips or high-performing ones. Once we have it, we can do so-called pre-layout simulation. Pre-layout simulation and verification. Can verify with another software tool the complete operation of the chip at the gate level, and then we can check if it is okay or it is not okay. If it's not okay, of course, we go back to the design capture stage to modify what is not working. If it's okay, we can go to the physical implementation. So here we are crossing the boundary from the, let's say, functional structure to the physical implementation. In terms of the physical implementation, what do we need to do? The easy steps. First, we need to make a floor planning. Because, for example, we know how many standard cells we need, and so more or less how big is the chip. So we can decide more or less the size of the whole chip, and let's say assign the different regions to the different parts of the chip. So it's a high-level positioning of the main building blocks. Then we can do the placement and routing. Placement of the standard cells and of the macro cells and routing. And also this is done with software tools. Then we can make an electrical circuit extraction. we are at the physical level now. When we have done the placement and routing of the standard cells, we are at the transistor level. We can extract the complete electrical circuits with all transistors, capacitors, resistors, and so on. And then we can do so-called post-layout simulation, a layout of the complete chip. Post-layout simulation. So the post-layout simulation is a simulation done after we have made the physical layout. After we have the physical layout, we can do a post-layout simulation and verify again. If it's okay, we go to the foundry. If it's not, we go back here. Now, I need to add that these constraints that have been put here are used for the placement and routing. Of course, there are placement and routing constraints. They are used for the placement and routing. So there's an additional link from the functional structure to the physical implementation. And the reason is that, let's say, 20 years ago, more or less in the 90s, these constraints were not really required, because one could obtain a working circuit just proceeding without the placement and routing constraint. But then the point is, when the complexity of the chip increases and when you want to have a high performance, then if you do not remember the constraints that you have on the timing of the circuits when you do the physical implementation, you can put the single building blocks too far away for everything to work. And then you cannot reach the so-called timing closure. You go in the second loop again and again, and you never reach a situation in which the circuit works, simply because you lost some specific requirement on, for example, a delay due to the distance between two blocks. And then, at present, it is let's say best practice in design to obtain with the logic synthesis also this information about the maximum delays that you want from the interconnections. Okay, when you send the layout to the foundry, you do a tape out. It's the way it is called. Also now, it was, let's say, historical reasons, because in the 90s, typically when you had a complete layout, you had to put the layout on a tape, and then you had to send the tape by express courier to the foundry. No. Of course, now you simply upload the file, but it's still called a tape out. Okay, now we need to explore the other parts of the possibilities that are the array-based implementations that we haven't discussed yet. The main difference between the array-based implementation and the standard cell implementation is that with the array-based implementation, you do not want to go to a foundry for a complete process. Okay? So the array-based implementation, as you shall see, do not require a complete manufacturing run. And what's the advantage of not doing a complete manufacturing run? A typical advantage is time, because a manufacturing run takes between 20 days and 3 months, So it's a lot. And also because of costs, because for a complete manufacturing run, you need to have a full set of masks that, as I mentioned, costs now a few millions. So it's not really cheap. If you have a small volume, you want to make 100 pieces for a small customer, then you cannot go to a foundry. So for this reason, as you shall see, this array-based implementation have a very low fixed cost and will have a very high variable cost. So they are good for very small volumes, because in that case, at least you have very small fixed costs. So the options are two types. One is the so-called, maybe I used a different name before. Let me just check. Here. Gate array, okay. Gate array. These are mask programmable arrays. Basically, you have in the fab some wafers in which you have several logic blocks, standard cells and more complex logic blocks. And then the only thing that is missing is the metal interconnections. So the design is limited to put the correct metal interconnections that you need for your design. Then you do not go through a complete manufacturing run, you only go to the foundry to put the final metal layers. Okay? This is the situation. So, they are pre-diffused wafers, only metal layers are missing. So it's similar to the standard cells, except for the fact that you already have the standard cells already put on silicon. So you only need to decide how to couple them, how to interconnect them. And of course, when you start from your design, you go to a gate level description, and then from a gate level description, typically guided by software, you obtain the interconnections that you need on the gate array. Then, if you want to, you send the metal layer layout to the foundry, and the foundry processes only the metal layers. That is typically very fast and very cheap, because it's the least expensive part of the process. This can work in the case you have also some simple standard cells, also some big macro cells, and then you connect all of them. Okay, this is pretty easy to understand. And then we have the field programmable gate array. The so-called FPGA, that are field programmable, which means that can be programmed in the field. You never go to the foundry. You have a manufacturing phase which is completely separated from the, let's say, from the implementation phase, because as we shall see, you can, let's say, decide the interconnections in your place. So you have a complete separation. Let's stress this aspect. Complete separation of the manufacturing phase from the implementation phase. And this is very good because you have large volume for the manufacturing phase, because the manufacturers can build FPGAs for a huge number of applications in extremely large volumes, so they can have high fixed costs, because they can, let's say, spread these costs over a large number of pieces. And then at the point of the implementation, you do not have any fixed costs anymore. You basically have only variable costs, because you buy each FPGA and then you program it. There are companies that are specialized in FPGA fabrication. They are fabless companies, by the way, also those ones. The biggest one is called Xilinx. The second biggest is called Altera. There are other smaller ones. And they are fabless, by the way. They are all fabless. So they use an external foundry. They design the FPGA and make it and let it do it, mostly TSMC. What's the advantage of using FPGA? Of course, the time to market can be extremely fast. It's very, very fast. It's just days. Okay. You have very low fixed costs, only your time. NRE, non-recurring expenditure. On the other hand, there are some disadvantages, because you have performance loss, which is huge. You typically have to use a lot of resources in terms of energy and of silicon to perform things that you could do with much fewer resources with a custom design. Really, sometimes you cry when you think of how many transistors you are spending for doing something very simple. And also, the same thing is true in terms of energy consumption. And for another, let's say, negative aspect is the fact that, on the other hand, you have variable costs that are pretty high. Because the single FPGA typically costs a lot. Let's say it's a good margin business, and Xilinx and Altera are making good money by sending the FPGA. The more complex FPGA chips can cost in a few hundred dollars each. So they can fabricate really millions of them per year on a large scale. And okay, for them it's a good business. This means that, of course, the use of FPGA is limited to situations in which you want to do prototyping, or in which you want to do a very small scale of a very small volume, hundreds, thousands of chips, but not more than that. Otherwise, it really becomes not economically viable. Let's have a bit of a look at the technology. How can we program the interconnections in a simple lab, let's say, by software? There are a few options how cells can be programmed. There are a few options. One is the so-called fuse-based FPGA. The fuse-based FPGA are also called write once. So you can program only once the FPGA, because you typically short circuit or you break a fuse. Fuse in Italian is a fusibile. Okay, so you can have two different situations. You have fuse, which are normally a short circuit. And then if you let high current flow through the fuse, you can basically blow up the fuse and break it. Okay? A high current can blow up the fuse. And so it becomes an open circuit. So this means that during the programming phase, you go through all the fuse that you want to open to transform in an open circuit, and you let a high current flow through them. The other options is to have an antifuse. With an antifuse, you have something which is normally open circuit. And if you let apply a voltage between the two terminals of the open circuit, you can basically break down the antifuse and transform it into an open into a short circuit. Typically, it's done in something like that. You have a metal, a thin dielectric in the middle, and another, for example, highly doped silicon. This can be a metal, or let's say it's poly. Sometimes it's better. It's poly. This is M plus silicon, for example. In the other direction, so we have a cross like this, and then in the middle we have a nitride layer, which is an insulator. And then, if we apply a high voltage between the poly and the silicon, we typically break down the nitride layer, and we have a short circuit. As you can see, the important thing to understand it is that it's a one-off. When you do it, it's done. You cannot change idea. Okay. If you make an error, you have to throw it away and take another one. Then there are non-volatile FPGA in which you have a non-volatile memory in which you can store the information. So, for example, you can have two wires here. Between the two wires, you have a MOSFET like this, with a second gate, as in non-volatile memory. You have an idea of how non-volatile memory works. You should have seen. I've seen that in the syllabus of the electronics class. There should be silence. We shall go back to non-volatile memories. But in case this can be on or off in the case this MOSFET. So if the MOSFET is on, of course, you have a short circuit. If the MOSFET is off, you have no open circuit, so you have no contact. And in this case, the transistor preserves the memory even when you switch the device off. So it's always closed or always open. So the status is conserved, and you can program this type of memories. It's a non-volatile. This is a non-volatile memory. If you don't remember it, we can. No, don't worry. We will come back to those. Then the other option is to have an SRAM FPGA, and actually this last one is the most common one, I should say. So again, you have a memory, but this time is a volatile memory. Is a memory that, of course, let's say, disappears when you switch the device off. So something must change. Basically, what you do is the following. When you switch everything on, the first thing you do, you need to connect the FPGA with an external memory. The first thing, when you switch off, the FPGA starts to read the memory, and according to what is read in the memory, rewrites all the SRAMs that are responsible to all the programmable parts. So it's like a shift register in which every bit of the shift register corresponds to a programmable junction. So this is the simplest part. The let's say the drawback of this situation is that in the case of a large FPGA, it takes time. If you have a large FPGA and you have tens of thousands of programmable junctions, then you need to wait some time to let's say download all the bits for all the junctions. This is the only drawback. The nice part of the SRAM is that it allows reconfigurability, because if you think about it, basically you can change the status of the hardware, change the connections during the operation. In principle, that is doable, because you do not need a specific high voltage for programming. It's similar to what one can do with a reconfigurable code, in which you go during the operation of the code, you change the instruction part of the memory, and then you change the code during the operation. It's high risky. It's very risky, but it's high risk. It's very risky, but it can be fun. Okay. Let's look at what is this logic. What type of logic can be programmed? We have seen that we can program some logic and basically switch on or off a connection, a short circuit. There are different options. Also, depending on the complexity of the flash memory. One option, the simplest one, is the so-called array-based programmable logic. It's very easy to understand if you... I did not check if you have done in the previous course the PLA, the programmable logic array. Let me just explain how it works. Basically, you have some inputs. Let's say this is A, this is B. I'm just drawing a simple example to give you an idea of how it works. Of course, it can be much more complex in terms of number of inputs and number of outputs, but let's just stop at three, because we can have much more inputs. This is not important. Then what you have, so you have this C, this is not C, so on this side, this is not B, and this is not A, of course. And then you have a so-called AND array. You have a three input AND, something like this, in which you have here a contact that has to be programmed. When I draw this large circle on a contact, it means that it can be programmed. So this means that in practice, you can connect to the first input C or C or not C. This is the programming that you can do, here B or not B, here A or not A. And this is the same for... Oh, no. For several rows, you can program the input of the NAND. And of course, you can do multiple times. Okay? So this is the AND array. Then you have the outputs. And in this case, you have an OR array. Just you can have programmable contacts here, and this is an OR. Of course, you know that with CMOS logic that this could be NAND NAND, it would be the same. So you can do any AND OR function, which means any combinatorial function. This is because, of course, any combinatorial function can be expressed as an OR of ANDs. And with the programmability, you can decide what's the input of every AND and what's the input of every OR. So all these have to be programmed. You can use a fuse or an antifuse and decide what happens here. So this is an example. Of course, there are situations in which you can program only the OR array or only the AND array or both, but I think that you have understood the general principle. Of course, this is okay for doing combinatorial functions. If you want to make if you want to implement sequential functions, you need something different. For example, you need some flip-flops, and for sequential logic, you need something different. For example, let me just give you an idea. You can have here an AND array, the AND array as before, which is programmable. You have a certain number of inputs, 1, 2, 3, etc., etc. Let's say number I of inputs. Okay, then you have the word lines that go out of the AND array. The product, these are the product terms. And then you have the OR array as before, OR array. The only difference, if you want to add to do sequential logic, is that for each output of the OR array, you can put a programmable flip-flop. You have the clock, and you have Q, and you have maybe a follower for going out. And then you can do the same for, let me put some points here. You can do the same for every exit. So you have the flip-flop. Some of them can go back to the programmable array. Some of them can go to the output so that you can build a sequential, a finite state machine, basically. Typically, this part also can be programmed by changing something. You can have a D flip-flop, a T flip-flop, a JK, etc., etc. This is programmable. So some quite simple, I would say, FPGA are like this. You have several cells, and each cell is a PLA with a flip-flop. With several flip-flops. So you can perform any sequential logic function or any combinatorial logic function with a given complexity, and you can combine them. That is, let's say, a relatively simple situation. Using programmable arrays. Another thing that is pretty common is using cell-based programmable logic. I'm almost done. In the case of cell-based programmable logic, you have basically you have to use logic blocks that can perform several functions. And frankly, two of them are used typically. One is the multiplexer, because you know that the multiplexer can actually be used as a programmable gate. It can perform several functions. If you take it, just a 2-to-1 multiplexer, you have A and B, then this is the output and this is the selector. For example, let's say 0 and 1 goes like this. Then if you have, just if you want, if we look at the truth table, you can see that when S is 0 and B is 0, so S is 0, B, whatever is B, it is not important, F is equal to A. If A is X, F is X. If S is 1 and B is Y, A can be whatever it wants, but we have Y. If S is X and B is Y, and A is 0, for example, F is XY. Because if S is 1 and B is 1, we have 1, otherwise we have 0. So we have an AND. But for example, if S is X and A is Y and B is 1, you can see that basically if X is 1, we have F equal to B, which is 1. If X is Z, if X is 0, then F is equal to A, so we have X plus 1, X plus Y. So we have an OR. So basically, depending on what we put on S, we can program the multiplexer to behave as an OR, an AND, or we can continue with other functions. That is pretty easy to see. So this is a situation that is, the multiplexer is used very frequently as a programmable logic function, logic gate. The other option that we can have is to use as a programmable logic gate a memory, the so-called lookup table. What does it mean? Basically, we have a memory here with, for example, 4 SRAM, one bit SRAM, and then we have here a multiplexer with 2 input, Y1 and Y2, for example, and this is F. And basically, if this is 0, 0, this is 0, 1, this is 1, 1, 0, this is 1, 1, what you see is that depending on what you write in the memory, you can use the Y1 and Y2 as 2 inputs of your logic gates and F as the output. and the operation of the logic gate, the lookup table of the logic gate is decided in the memory, is what you write in the memory. So basically, for any function, you write the lookup table in the memory, and then you use the multiplexer to connect the input to the output. For example, if we write 0, 0, 0, and 1 in the memory, then we have this operation. We have 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1. So we have an end. We have an end logic gate. So this is particularly easy to do with an SRAM or a flash-based FPGA. For every combinatorial function, you write the lookup table in a memory in the FPGA. And you also can have a combination of them, of course. So, multiplexer plus a lookup table. Then there is also another option, but I do not have time now, so we can continue next time, in which you basically do not change the the cells, but you only act on the interconnections. You leave the cells as they are, and you basically program the gate array with interconnections, but we shall see it next time.